Welcome back, ReZero fans, to the Sloth If story, also known as the Rem If story. Last video was part one, where we covered the first two chapters of the Rem If prequel, so if you haven't seen that video yet, you can find a link to it in this video's description. This video is part two of the series, and we will be covering chapter three, but before I begin the summary, let's go ahead and do a quick recap of everything that's happened thus far. Rem and Subaru ran away together and got married, leaving Amelia behind to die. Now, as a lot of you pointed out in the previous video, when Amelia dies, Puck is supposed to try to destroy the world. But obviously, the world hasn't ended in this If story, so we can only assume that someone in Lagoonica was powerful enough to kill Puck. However, it is highly likely that thousands of innocent people were frozen to death in the process. Anyway, Subaru and Rem move to a Kararagi town called Banan, where Subaru finally gets a job. 1 month later, a mysterious white-haired woman tries to kill him, but luckily he is saved by Halibal. Later that night, the same woman shows up again, except her outfit and personality are completely different, and she no longer has the desire to kill Subaru. After she leaves, Subaru discovers that Rem is pregnant with his child, and then the two of them share a nice little happy moment together. The next chapter picks up right where we left off. Chapter 3, 3 months. After learning of Rem's pregnancy, the happily married couple spent the entire night celebrating. The next morning, Halibal stops by to say hello, but Subaru is kind of upset with him. Remember, nobody told Subaru that Halibal was the strongest person in Kararagi. Subaru had thought Halibal was just an average guy, so when he saw him in action for the first time, he was pretty shocked and even a bit offended. Truthfully, Subaru had grown suspicious of Halibal. Everything he had previously thought about him turned out to be a lie, so now he didn't know what was real anymore. Could he even trust Halibal? He wasn't sure. And that kind of hurt Halibal's feelings. Halibal didn't want Subaru to treat him any differently from before, so to ease the tension a little bit, he jokingly threatens Rem and Subaru's lives and then laughs his ass off. I think it was at this point when Subaru realized Halibal hasn't really changed at all. But Halibal goes on to explain a little bit of his backstory. His wolf-human species is almost extinct. He's one of the last surviving shinobi warriors, he knows how to use curses, and he specializes in attacking his opponent's weak points, but he's not allowed to explain how he fights. All we really need to know is that the shinobi were a group of ninjas, and of course, ninjas were Japanese. And by the way, all the buildings in Kararagi have Edo period architecture, which was actually the same time ninjas were prevalent in Japan. So once again guys, Japanese culture has heavily influenced Kararagi for some reason. Anyway, at some point, Subaru decides to thank Halibal for saving his life. Halibal accepts his thanks and then takes a big puff of whatever's in his pipe. But obviously, Subaru doesn't want him smoking around Rem anymore, so he tells him, "Halibal, could you please not smoke tobacco around my pregnant wife?" To which Halibal replies, "Oh, don't worry, Subaru. This isn't tobacco." Yeah, apparently Halibal has to smoke medicinal herbs constantly throughout the day in order to stay alive. Well, at least that's what he says. Anyway, the conversation takes a more serious turn when Halibal brings up the white-haired woman from the previous night. Subaru's first thought was that the woman's another Sin Archbishop of the witch cult, but Rem tells him that's not the case. Remember, for some reason, Rem can smell the witch's scent, and apparently that woman didn't smell like the witch at all. In fact, Halibal couldn't smell her either, which is odd because as a wolf human, his nose is supposed to be very reliable. Now, they have no idea when the woman will attack again, so Subaru decides to take a day off from work and spend the day inside the apartment protecting Rem. But there's a problem. It's not like Subaru can just call in sick, so he actually has to physically go and tell his boss that he's taking the day off. And guess who he runs into on his way there? "Why are you staring at me?" the white-haired woman says. It was broad daylight, so Subaru could finally see her face clearly. Her face was definitely too beautiful to be human. She looked out of place in public, almost like she instead belonged inside a picture painted by God himself. The woman sighs and says, "Well, whatever. I guess we can talk on our way to your apartment." Subaru's initial response was to resist, but he quickly realized he couldn't stop her even if he tried to. She could kill him at any moment if she wanted to, so he really had no choice but to comply. As the two of them walk together back to the apartment, the woman starts humming a song out loud. For a second, she didn't seem dangerous at all, but Subaru wasn't gonna let his guard down just yet. They eventually arrive back at the apartment where they find Hallible and Rem. Hallible immediately tries to flirt with the woman, but she rejects him and calls him a mutt. Rem invites everyone inside to talk and offers to make some tea. Rem's politeness appeared to put the woman in a better mood, so she introduces herself. "For now, you can just call me Tia," she says. Tia explains that she doesn't want to kill anyone for the time being, so long as they simply return what they've stolen from her. As she says this, she looks directly at Rem. "Respond carefully," she says. "Yes is the only answer I want to hear. Rem, give me back my light ball." A strong blade of wind blew past Rem and lacerated the wall behind her. But Rem was much more confused than she was intimidated. She definitely didn't steal anything from Tia, nor did she know what a light ball even was. But Tia wasn't satisfied with Rem's confused response. "I warned you," she says, as another gust of wind ravages the apartment, showering the walls with cuts and gashes. Luckily, none of them hit Rem, because if they had, she would have been split in half. Also, for some reason, Hallible stood in the corner watching silently. The previous night, he had protected Rem and Subaru and actually fought the woman, but now he was just standing there, perfectly calm. Tia asks Rem the question one last time, "Where is my light ball?" But Rem still has no idea what she's talking about. Tia's anger finally explodes and the terrifying wind magic devastates the entire room. The walls, the door, the furniture, and the floor were all obliterated by Tia's destruction. However, Subaru, Rem, and Hallible themselves remained unharmed. The blades of wind flying randomly around the room had somehow avoided them. It was almost like the attacks weren't actually random and Tia was controlling them manually so that they wouldn't hurt anyone, as if she was just trying to scare them. Subaru picks up on this and accuses Tia of bluffing. In response, Tia finally gives up and lets out a sigh and starts pouting.
"Look, I didn't know Rem was pregnant," she says.
She explains that normally she would have just killed Rem for stealing her property, but because the baby didn't do anything wrong, killing it would go against her beliefs as a Shinigami. She tells everyone that if Rem doesn't give her back the light ball, she's just gonna have to wait until the baby is born to kill Rem. Everyone in the room just kind of stares at Tia, giving her weird looks. Her face turns red as she gets embarrassed and starts stomping on the ground saying,
"Stop looking at me like I'm crazy. Rem is a thief and I know it."
They all keep staring at her and Rem points out that Tia's bad behavior was similar to that of the children she teaches at the elementary school. Rem points her finger at Tia and scolds her saying,
"Tia-sama, we would like to help you find your light ball, but not until you learn how to behave, understand?"
Tia nods her head timidly and quietly says,
"Yes, I understand."
And just like that, Rem had easily taken control of the situation and Tia was now acting like a child awaiting punishment. Rem gets Tia to promise not to attack anyone unless she can actually prove that they took her light ball. But from now on, Tia's gonna watch Rem and Subaru closely and try and gather evidence that they stole it. Meaning that yes, Tia wants to live with Rem and Subaru from now on.
"Hell no," Subaru says.
If Tia's living with them, Subaru won't have any alone time with Rem, which obviously means no more sex. Now, as we know, Subaru absolutely has to fuck Rem every night or else their marriage might suffer, so there's no way Tia can live in the same apartment as them. They decide to move to the empty apartment next door and give Tia their old one. Plus, Tia basically ruined the old apartment with wind magic anyway, so it's not like they wanted to live there anymore, nor did they want to pay for the damages. As they explain this to her, Tia was taken aback at how forceful they were. Earlier, she felt like she held all the power in the situation, but quickly lost her initiative, ended up submitting to Rem's motherly scolding, and now she's agreeing to pay for an apartment she destroyed only minutes earlier.
"You guys are kinda tough," she says.
And that was the first time Subaru actually agreed with the beautiful, unreasonable Shinigami. Later that day, Rem punishes Tia by making her clean up the apartment. Meanwhile, Hallible and Subaru walk outside to talk in private. Now that they were finally alone, Halible admits that the reason he didn't protect them earlier was because, as a shinobi, he's able to read people's emotions flawlessly, and apparently Tia didn't show any signs of hostility even as she was destroying the apartment. However, she is still quite dangerous and could possibly pose a threat to them again in the future. And because Halible can't detect her scent, he might not be able to stop her if she attacks again. So remember last chapter, Halible told Subaru he had something important to ask him. Suddenly, the air around Halible grew colder as he asked Subaru the question, "Do you want me to get rid of her?" Subaru took a while to answer, but ultimately decides to let her live. He didn't want Halible to play the role of a villain, and because Rem appears to trust Tia already, Subaru decided that he should as well. The cold air coming from Halible's body vanished within an instant, and he went back to being the same old sluggish wolf. Halible laughed at Subaru for so easily forgiving someone who had almost murdered him, but little did he know, Subaru was actually married to someone who had murdered him. Rem walks outside with Tia and tells Subaru and Halible to come inside and help pick out some clothes for Tia to wear. Subaru and Halible head back inside, and the chapter ends. Now, the next chapter is titled 6 months, so there's going to be a 3 month time skip, and I'm excited to see how Tia's adapted to living next door to Rem and Subaru. I thought this chapter was pretty good. It was mostly dialogue, but I was definitely entertained. We got some more information about Halible, which is always good, and we finally learned the name of the white-haired girl. Tia is what she's going by at the moment, which I believe is a nickname for Zarestia. I mean, we know Zarestia is a great spirit that uses wind magic and lives in Karoragi, and this woman fits that description perfectly. A lot of my subscribers thought that she was a zombie Amelia or something, but I feel like Subaru would have at least recognized her if that was the case. Plus, if she's a great spirit, that would also explain why she's so incredibly powerful. However, this mystery is far from solved. Even if she is the great spirit Zarestia, why is there two of her? A detail I didn't mention in this summary was, throughout this whole chapter, Tia made references to beating up Subaru in the apartment the night before, but she never mentioned trying to kill him in the street earlier that same night. So we can assume she either doesn't have memory of that, or it was someone else. Another interesting detail was when she called herself a Shinigami. Is she actually a Shinigami, or is it just a cool title she gave herself? Let me know what you guys think. And lastly, there's also this light ball we've been hearing about. What is the light ball, and why is it so important to her, and why is she so convinced that Rem is the one who stole it? I personally think Rem is definitely innocent. I highly doubt she stole the light ball, but that raises the question, who did? Again, guys, let me know in the comments if you have any theories, but also let me know how you felt about this chapter. We've got a lot more material to cover, so remember to like the video if you want to see this series continue, and don't forget to subscribe so you'll be notified when part 3 comes out. That's all I got for you guys today. I kept this video a little short because I wanted to get it out as fast as possible, so I hope you guys enjoyed it. I'm out for now, though. Keep talking about ReZero, and don't let the season 2 hype die down. Peace out, guys.